trust you. Like a tree that cannot be moved. You say jump to arms wide open.
gotta be another way out. I've been stuck in a cage with my doubt. I've tried forever getting out on my own. Every time I do this my way, I get caught in the lies of the enemy. I lay my troubles down, I'm ready for you now. Bring me out, come and find me in the dark now. Every day by myself I'm breaking down. I don't wanna fight alone anymore. Bring me out, from the prison of my own pride. My God, I need a hope I can't deny. In the end I'm realizing, I was never meant to fight on my own. Every little thing is everything I need to let go. You're so much bigger than the world I have made. So I surrender my soul. I'm reaching out for your hope. I lay my weapons down, I'm ready.
All right, let's worship the Lord together.
Worship you now. How great, how awesome is he. Final breath. death and it was finished, but not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake, and the veil was torn. What sacrifice was made as the heavens rise? All hail King Jesus. All hail the Lord of heaven and earth. All hail King Jesus.
Yes, Jesus, you are the one that we worship and we honor and we praise, the only one worthy of it all. Jesus, thank you for coming to this earth, for humbly living, Lord, and dying for us to save us so that we could have a relationship with you and the Father and the Holy Spirit. You invited us into that relationship. You extended the hand first. It wasn't by anything that we did, but what you have done for us. Thank you for this free gift of salvation that you offer to all. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's turn and say hello to one another.
King of Kings. feel the promise. Your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on
it. Then came the morning.
Then came the morning. The promise, your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on it. Jesus, yours is the victory.
you, Lord, that you are just, Lord, that never-ending fountain of water, God, that our thirst is never, Lord, would never be, Lord, just we will always be quenched by you, God. And thank you for filling us up, God. Thank you for always giving us what we need, Lord, and for your provision, God. And thank you for just who you are, God. You're so worthy of our praise, God, so worthy of our worship. God, be exalted here tonight, God, in your name, amen.
All right, we're in Ezekiel chapter 37. I'm going to flip over there. Yes. Well, next weekend, I'll be up at the Appleton Prophecy Conference teaching there. So if you're really into prophecy, there'll be a lot of Bible teachers up there next weekend. We'll still have service here, so Friday night will still be going on. Sunday morning, I'm in Second Peter. So we'll be here with that. Tomorrow morning, men's study. Monday night, women gather for prayer. It should be picking up women's Bible study pretty soon in the fall here. And then Tuesday morning, mom's group meets here. So another Bible study. Wednesday night, going through Genesis. So that's always a blessing. And Friday mornings, another women's study. So if you can't make it at the night, you can come to that one. That'll be awesome. Father, thank you, Lord, for your word. Oh, God, especially these passages of scripture like this, God, that are just so relevant, Lord, even though they were prophesied so long ago. I pray that your Holy Spirit, who's been sent to teach us and instruct us, lead us through your word, Lord, that he would be our teacher tonight, God. I'm just lips, just a mouthpiece, God. Your word is what is powerful. So speak to our hearts, God, and Lord, just fill us with information, God, but I pray that your word would cause us to live accordingly, God. You are worth it. You are worthy, God. We bow before you. It's one thing to raise my hands and praise you. It's another thing, Lord, to raise my hand in a public square and say, I follow Jesus and I'm not ashamed. May that be what translates into our life, God. Bless your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Ezekiel 37, verse 1, the hand of the Lord came upon me and brought me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of the valley, and it was full of bones. Then he caused me to pass by them all around, and behold, there were very many in the open valley, and indeed, they were very dry. And he said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? So I answered, O Lord God, you know. Again he said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, surely I will cause breath to enter into you and you shall live. I will put sinews on you and bring flesh upon you, cover you with skin and put breath in you, and you shall live. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I prophesied, there was a noise and suddenly a rattling. And the bones came together, bone to bone. Indeed, as I looked, the sinews and the flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them over, but there was no breath in them. Also he said to me, prophesy the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath came into them, and they lived and stood upon their feet, an exceedingly great army. It's a very familiar passage of scripture for many believers. They made songs about it, stories about it. It's been used to illustrate different aspects of a person's spiritual life. But in the context of this book of Ezekiel, it depicts a significant prophetic event that has been coming to pass over the last several decades in the Middle East, which is amazing, seeing as this was a prophetic vision given to a Hebrew prophet over 2,500 years ago. As we'll see when we get to chapter 38, this is an extended prophecy that deals with events predicted as taking place just prior to the coming of the promised Jewish Messiah, or what we as followers of Jesus Christ have come to know as the Messiah's second coming. The event described in chapter 38 is an invasion of the land promised to Israel by a coalition of nations whom God will assemble. And if you watch the news, you see they are being assembled right now, but unbeknownst to them, God's assembling them. They will believe that they're operating by their own power, as we'll see. But God's going to use this end times event to show forth his glory to the nations of the earth. If you turn back or look ahead in chapter 38, verse 16, real quick. That's what the Lord says to them. You will come up against my people Israel like a cloud, speaking to this coalition of nations, to cover the land. It will be in the latter days that I will bring you against my land so that the nations may know me when I am hallowed in you, O Gog, before their eyes. The fascinating thing about this particular prophecy of Gog and Magog, as it's called, what's fascinating is that the prophet Ezekiel spends several chapters explaining in several ways how that invasion is going to take place after God has drawn the nation of Israel back to the promised land from an extended period of being dispersed among all the other nations of the earth. So turn back to chapter 34. We've been studying this in context. Go to chapter 34. This is where this extended prophecy here began. Verse 1 of chapter 34, and the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God to the shepherds. Woe to the shepherds of Israel who feed themselves. Should not the shepherds feed the flocks? You eat the fat, you clothe yourselves with wool, you slaughter the fatlings, but you do not feed the flock. The weakest you have not strengthened, nor have you healed those who were sick, nor bound up the broken, nor brought back what was driven away, nor sought what was lost, but with force and cruelty you have ruled them. So they were scattered, because there was no shepherd, and they became food for all the beasts of the field. When they were scattered, my sheep wandered through all the mountains and on every high hill. Yes, my flock was scattered over the whole face of the earth. This is not speaking just of the Babylonian captivity. God's flock, his chosen nation Israel, scattered over the whole face of the earth, and no one was seeking or searching for them. Drop down to verse 11. For thus says the Lord God, indeed I myself will search for my sheep and seek them out. As a shepherd seeks out his flock on the day he is among his scattered sheep, so will I seek out my sheep and deliver them from all the places where they were scattered on a cloudy and dark day. And I will bring them out from the peoples, the Goyim, the Gentiles, gather them from the countries, and will bring them to their own land. I will feed them on the mountains of Israel, in the valleys, and in all the inhabited places of the country. Now turn ahead to chapter 36, verse 8. All of this is speaking in preparation of what is going to take place in this invasion, Gog and Magog. Verse 8, chapter 36, but you, O mountains of Israel, you shall shoot forth your branches, yield your fruit to my people Israel, for they are about to come. For indeed I am for you, and I will turn to you, and you shall be tilled and sown. I will multiply men upon you, all the house of Israel, all of it, and the city shall be inhabited and the ruins rebuilt. I will multiply upon you man and beast, and they shall increase and bear young. I will make you inhabited as in former times, and do better for you than at your beginnings. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. Drop down to verse 16. Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, when the house of Israel dwelt in their own land, they defiled it by their own ways and their deeds. To me, their way was like the uncleanness of a woman in her customary impurity. Therefore I poured out my fury on them for the blood that they had shed on the land and for their idols with which they defiled it. So I scattered them among the nations, and they were dispersed throughout the countries. I judged them according to their ways and their deeds. When they came to the nations, wherever they went, they profaned my holy name when they said of them, these are the people of the Lord, and yet they have gone out of his land. So there's this emphasis, as you read through this extended prophecy, chapter 34, through 37 here, and then on into 38 and 39. There's an emphasis in these opening chapters upon Israel in the future day, when Ezekiel was, from when Ezekiel was prophesying, having been scattered into all the nations of the earth, no homeland, no capital, no government, no common language, no Israeli currency, nothing to bind them together. And yet they will maintain a national identity, something that apart from God doing it would be impossible. It is impossible. It's never happened before in the history of the world that such a nation would come back together, not coincidentally, but as predicted in multiple ancient documents. It's why God says to Israel in Isaiah 44, you are my witnesses to the world. You know, you witness to somebody. God says Israel is his witness to the world. You bring up Israel. You start talking to them about that. You know, people say, oh, I don't believe the Bible. It's been changed by man. Explain Israel to me. It's their book. I'm following their Messiah. Explain how this nation can be. I remember going to a doctor, and she was a Jewish woman, and, you know, she said, well, this is the behavior you're describing, which was, you know, really awful behavior in my youth. It sounds like it was in the past. When did this all end? I said to this Jewish doctor, it ended the night that I received your Messiah as my Savior and began to witness to her about her own heritage. I said, think of your heritage. Here I'm at this woman doctor, you know, she's supposed to be prescribing things for me. I was prescribing things for her. And so this nation's going to come back together. God dispersed them out of his land into exile due to their transgressions against his law. And God has regathered them back into his land once again. All of it in order to maintain the integrity of his word, his promises made to their forefathers, as it says in chapter 36, verse 22. Therefore say to the house of Israel, thus says the Lord God, I do not do this for your sake, O house of Israel, but for my holy name's sake. He's not doing it for them. He's doing it for him, for his name's sake, which you have profaned among the nations wherever you went. And I sanctify my great name, which has been profaned among the nations, which you have profaned in their midst. And the nations shall know that I am the Lord, says the Lord God, when I am hallowed in you before their eyes. As we've seen in numerous places while studying Bible prophecy here on Friday nights, Israel's regathering is not simply for them to become a secular nation either. As is pointed out here, they were regathered from their dispersion out amongst other nations of the earth back into the promised land for a future regeneration, which is described in these verses in chapter 36 as well. The same thing that has happened to those of us who have been born again will happen to the nation of Israel. Chapter 36, verse 24, where it says, for I will take you from among the nations, gather you out of all countries, bring you into your own land. Then I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean. I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all your idols. I will give you a new heart, put a new spirit within you. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you, cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my judgments and do them. This is what will happen to Israel collectively as a nation once they are regathered back in the promised land. I've been to Israel several times. This is not describing the nation right now. They are filthy. You know, there's segments of the Jews living there, but of the millions, almost 10 million now, most of them are secular. But sometime after this upcoming invasion that we're going to read about in chapters 38 and 39, this is going to take place to the nation. Right now, we're right in between verses 24 and 25 of chapter 36, where he says, for I will take you from among the nations, gather you out from all the countries, bring you into your own land. This is where we are. But then, after this invasion, I will sprinkle clean water on you. You shall be clean. I will cleanse you from all your filthiness, all your idols. Now, chapter 37 provides a detailed prophetic account of how the nation of Israel will miraculously come back alive, so that to prepare them for God to fulfill these promises of his, that he will be faithful to bring about and is bringing about already. We're going to Israel in 2025. If you want to see it for yourself, you want to see it with your own eyes, sign up. You can go in the back and sign up. You can go over there and see how this is all taking place. Verses 1 through 10 of chapter 37 describe this vision that Ezekiel had. Verses 11 through 14 will provide the interpretation. So he says in verse 1, the hand of the Lord came upon me and brought me out in the spirit of the Lord, set me down in the midst of the valley, and it was full of bones. It's a very unique way of introducing a prophecy here in the Old Testament, even for Ezekiel. If you've been following along, if you've ever studied this book, you know that Ezekiel was a Hebrew prophet living in exile during the Babylonian captivity, through whom God spoke to his wayward nation by way of some pretty eccentric methods, all to get the people's attention. At one point, God had Ezekiel going in and out through a hole in the wall of his house. God had him lay on the ground in public for months. He was not allowed to mourn when his wife died. He was not allowed to speak for an extended period of time. And he had to eat food cooked over manure. So you think you're called to do difficult tasks. Just think about this poor guy. But these were the things God had to have Ezekiel do just to get the attention of the spiritually deaf people he was trying to speak to. Much of Ezekiel's prophetic ministry was to his generation, pointing out the reasons for God's need to remove Israel from the promised land in the first place. In some of his earlier visions, he was taken in the spirit, as it's saying here, or by the spirit from Babylon back to Jerusalem. And he was shown the sad spiritual condition God's chosen people were in, worshiping idols, false gods, right there in the temple. In this vision, however, Ezekiel is taken not just to a different location geographically, he is taken to a different time period. When people are given glimpses of the future like this here in the Bible, it's not like some fiction novel where they're imagining something. But God's prophets are allowed to actually see what God already sees. As God transcends time, God sees the end from the beginning. He sees the future. I can trust him with tomorrow. He knows what tomorrow is going to bring. To say the hand of the Lord was upon me, verse 1, is a way of saying by God's divine power. Ezekiel was brought out of his time period through means of the Holy Spirit. And Ezekiel was set down in the midst of the valley, it says. There's a definite article before that word in the Hebrew. So a specific valley, the valley, it's not identified, only that it was full of human bones, among which the Holy Spirit directed Ezekiel to walk all around them, verse 2, so as to make a thorough inspection of them, whereby Ezekiel could say conclusively, there were very many scattered across the surface of this valley, and they were very dry. So they were weathered and bleached, in other words, from laying there for a long period. Verse 3, and he said to me, son of man, can these bones live? So I answered, O Lord God, you know. So this question is posed to Ezekiel in preparation of something miraculous that God is about to do. Ezekiel's answer is much like the Apostle John's answers to the angel that's showing him various visions in the book of Revelation. He'd say, what do you see? And John would say, you tell me what I'm seeing. Good way to answer. When asked if these ancient, weathered, dead for centuries bones could live again, Ezekiel wisely doesn't say yes or no. As a true servant of God, Ezekiel had no hope in the bones, but he did have hope in God. Only you, Lord God, know the answer to that, is Ezekiel's literal answer in the original language. Verse 4 again, he said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, surely I will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live. I will put sinews on you and bring flesh upon you, cover you with skin and put breath in you, and you shall live. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. So God doesn't just wave a magic wand and perform his pleasure, even though that would be no problem. He could do that. But he speaks his word through ordinary people. And it's like the more ordinary, the more foolish, the better. That's who God picks. He takes the foolish to confound the wise. Takes the weak to bring to nothing those that are everything. And I read that list in 1 Corinthians and I say, man, I finally qualify for something, you know. It probably wouldn't seem, it would probably seem pretty foolish for Ezekiel to talk to a bunch of dead bones, but he does anyway, because it's God's word he's speaking. Now, I read of this famous pastor once. He was visiting a church, sitting in the service with his wife, listening to the pastor of the church speaking. Famous pastor, all through the service, you know, he's sitting there, this visiting pastor's dissecting the pastor's speech, his grammar, his delivery of his sermon, how his sermon points are not all that inspiring as he thought. You know, oh, that's kind of good. That's a good point. Oh, that's not really good. Until he's thinking, oh, this isn't very inspiring, until he turns to look at his wife to make a comment on the pastor's poor performance, only to find his wife is weeping. He said they realized at that point that the power is in the Word of God. The power of the Word of God had nothing to do with the speaker's grammar or deliverance. God can use a donkey to speak if he wants. The power is in God's Word, and as Jesus taught in the parable of the sower, it is in the receptiveness of the heart. The man sitting in the church service that day realized the problem was with him, not with God's Word. I can receive all kinds of blessings from God if I am willing to receive it, if I'm not critical, if my pride doesn't keep me from doing so. It might have seemed foolish at the time for Ezekiel to speak to dry bones, like what good's that gonna do? But that which Ezekiel was commanded to prophesy, as foolish as it might have seemed then, in verse 4, it's still being read and studied 2,500 years later by people like us. Obviously very important. In fact, it's more relevant today than ever before. Ezekiel was simply God's mouthpiece at that time. The Lord spoke, as verse 5 says, the words being presented in first person. Surely, or most definitely, I am going to do this, God says. The Hebrew word ruach, translated breath, in both verses 5 and 6 is used with a different verb in each verse. I will cause breath to enter you, verse 5 says. That's speaking of physical life being given so as to reanimate bones that have flesh on them. Once that's taken place, verse 6 says, I will put breath in you and you shall live. Speaking there of spiritual life. So it's a very specific, as is emphasized in the prophecies here in Ezekiel that lead up to Gog and Magog prophecy in chapters 38 and 39. Here in these prophecies that lead up to that, they speak of a coming invasion that's going to change the spiritual dynamics of this earth in preparation for the Lord's return. But emphasizing these chapters leading up to that, as I've been pointing out, is the initial regathering of the nation Israel physically back into the promised land. So it's something that we see taking place already. And not only are they regathering, but they have the whole world's attention. You cannot turn on the news, man, without Israel being there somewhere. And God said that's how it would be. And it's not just coincidental. It's not a coincidental fluke, and it's not in some obscure place. God has placed them right in the middle of everything, and that's only going to intensify. If you're watching the right things, you watch what's going on in the Middle East. That is where everything's intensifying. Satan would have you look at everything in our country, all the politics, everything around here. In America, the United States is not mentioned in end times prophecy at all. You got to know where to look. How faithful is God? You think with all these Old Testament prophecies of and all worldwide media exposure, all of it is just like a laser beam on there. God is so merciful. Someone has to not want to see it, to not see it. But this physical rebirth of the nation is only the first step. The promise here and in several other biblical prophecies is for the nation's spiritual regeneration at some point, which is alluded to in the command given to Ezekiel in verses 5 and 6, and then explained in more detail in verses 7 through 10, where it says, "So I prophesied, and I was commanded. And as I prophesied, there was a noise, and suddenly a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to bone. Indeed, as I looked, the sinews, flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them over, but there was no breath in them. Also he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath came into them, and they lived and stood upon their feet, an exceeding great army." Ezekiel just does what he's told. I prophesied as I was commanded. He doesn't add to God's command. He doesn't put his own personal spin on anything or take credit for the results. I prophesied as I was commanded, and things began to happen simply through the power of God's word. What was dry and dead, scattered all over, began little by little, piece by piece, to come back together. That's the picture in verse 8. After the bones reassemble, then actual flesh begins to form on them. Just as Israel remained a nation for 2,000 years, even though there was no physical entity operating as an earthly nation, the thought of Israel reassembling as an ethnic nation back in their same land, resurrecting the dead Hebrew language, totally resurrecting forgotten Jewish shekel as their money, all of which is prophesied in the Old Testament, that would seem absurd. And many denominations within Christianity began to reject that idea. But to those believing the word of God and the words of the prophets like Ezekiel, Israel still existed here on the pages of this book and throughout the world. And just as prophets like Ezekiel, many others who spoke for God, just as they said May 14th, 1948, the dry bones scattered all over the world began to take on physical life as an earthly nation once again. Who has heard such a thing? Isaiah 66:8 asks, speaking of this event. Who's seen such things? Shall the earth be made to give birth in one day? Or shall a nation be born at once? For as soon as Zion was in labor, she gave birth to her children. In one day, Israel was recognized as a nation on the earth, just as Isaiah 66 says, just as God said would happen. And just as a physical body can have bones, muscles, skin, but no life until there's breath in the lungs, the breath of physical earthly life came into the nation of Israel 75 years ago, as is depicted by Ezekiel here in verse 9. Prophesy to the breath. Speak to the breath. Thus says the Lord, come from the four winds, breath, and breathe on the slain, that they shall live. Once again, when Ezekiel prophesied as commanded, the nation came alive and stood on their own two feet, so to speak, as an exceedingly great army, verse 10. That is a perfect description of the modern state of Israel. They're not only a formidable force politically, economically, scientifically, but also militarily. In their brief re-existence, they have won several wars facing overwhelming odds. There's, documentaries about them. I encourage you to study them if you haven't seen them, but it's why nations larger than them are hesitant to attack them anymore. The last time they got attacked from three different directions, totally overwhelmed, they took the Golan Heights, they took the West Bank, and they took the Sinai Peninsula, and were forced to give these back. And thankfully, they got the Golan Heights back by our last president. But that's what happens. You attack them, and they not only win, they take your land, okay? And so in this brief re-existence, this is what's going on. To anyone who knows the scriptures, it's obvious that their success cannot be attributed to any strength or superiority that they have. But God is fulfilling his word as he said. And so with so much already fulfilled, there's no reason to doubt that this final promise of their national regeneration will fail to come to pass, as well as Ezekiel is commanded to prophesy now, verse 11. Then he said to me, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. So in case you're wondering, there's no denying what he's talking about. They indeed say our bones are dry, our hope is lost, and ourselves are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, O my people, I will open your graves and cause you to come up from your graves and bring you into the land of Israel. Then you shall know that I am the Lord when I have opened your graves, O my people, and brought you up from your graves. I will put my spirit in you, and you shall live, and I will place you in your own land. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken it and performed it, says the Lord. The Apostle Paul wrote in Romans 11, verse 25, for I do not desire, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you should be wise in your own opinion, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. And so, or that's when all Israel will be saved. Romans chapter 11. A future reality that's being depicted here by the prophet Ezekiel. He's using the language of resurrection. God says he will open their graves, verse 12, and bring them physically back into the land so that out of all the potential real estate on the earth, they would be gathered back to that specific spot on the planet. And they, Israel, will know the truth of who God is, verse 13, and know him personally. I don't know what happened to you when you got saved, when you were born again, but I know the night my wife and I prayed and received the gospel, received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, I knew who God was. I know who he is. I know him personally. I go talk to him every morning. His word speaks to me. His Holy Spirit dwells within me. This is what he's talking about here. He puts his spirit in them, verse 14, then they will truly live. This is the second fulfillment of their being regathered from all the nations of the earth, the second fulfillment that is yet to come to pass. The big military event that we're going to see depicted in chapters 38 and 39, that is going to play a large role in furthering that coming regeneration of the nation. That's what's described there. That's how God is going to wake them up. So it says in verse 15, again, the word of the Lord came to me saying, as for you, son of man, take a stick for yourself and write on it for Judah and for the children of Israel, his companions. Then take another stick and write on it for Joseph, the stick of Ephraim, and for all the house of Israel, his companions. Then join them one to another for yourself into one stick, and they will become one in your hand. Here the prophecy switches from the imagery of these dry bones to the imagery of two sticks, so as to make a coinciding point to the prophecy of Israel's regathering to the land. As is seen in the historical books of the Old Testament, before Israel was taken into captivity the first time to Babylon, they had been divided into two separate nations, north and south, Israel and Judah, that actually come to a place of warring against one another. But in their future regathered state, in anticipation of their national regeneration, there will be no longer two separate nations. But here, using symbolism that is similar to Numbers chapter 17, where Moses was commanded to take the children of Israel, have them write the names of each of the 12 tribes on 12 separate rods, or these wooden sticks, similar to the language here, and these were used to determine God's tribal choice for the priesthood. In that case, Aaron's rod budded and produced fruit overnight, a very obvious choice. But the same type of symbolism is used here to depict a united Israel when this takes place. Judah, verse 16, was the dominant tribe in the south and eventually became the nation of Judah in the Old Testament. Joseph and his son Ephraim, in particular, was the dominant tribe in the north, who along with the other nine northern tribes became the nation of Israel. As is pointed out in verse 16, however, the true children of Israel, the faithful remnant, remained within the southern nation of Judah. But those two separate nations were to be depicted on two separate sticks that were to then be somehow joined together into one stick in Ezekiel's hand, something that would raise the curiosity of the people around Ezekiel. Verse 18, and when the children of your people speak to you, saying, will you not show us what you mean by these? Say to them, thus says the Lord God, surely I will take the stick of Joseph, which is in the hand of Ephraim, and the tribes of Israel, his companions, and I will join them with it, with the stick of Judah, and make them one stick, and they will be one in my hand. So no longer a divided nation in God's hand, as in when they are being used for God's purposes once again here on earth. Israel will be a unified nation in the days leading up to the Gog-Magog invasion of chapter 38. And as Ezekiel was holding these symbolic sticks before their eyes, verse 20, it says in verse 21, and the sticks on which you write will be in your hand before their eyes. Then say to them, verse 21, thus says the Lord God, surely I will take the children of Israel from among the nations, wherever they've gone, and will gather them from every side and bring them into their own land. And I will make them one nation in the land on the mountains of Israel. And one king shall be king over them all. They shall no longer be two nations, nor shall they ever be divided into two kingdoms again. They shall not defile themselves anymore with their idols, nor with their detestable things, nor with any of their transgressions. But I will deliver them from all their dwelling places in which they have sinned and will cleanse them. Then they shall be my people. I will be their God. So here the focus of this prophecy is revealed to be speaking of the ultimate regeneration of the nation of Israel, as they will exist prior to their entrance into the Messianic kingdom. Even in New Testament time period, there remained division there within the promised land, as various gospel narratives speak about the animosity between the Jews and the Samaritans, Galileans. They were very divided. But in preparation for their entrance into the coming Messianic kingdom, all divisions within the Jewish nation will be supernaturally removed. When God personally takes the children of Israel from among the nations, wherever they've gone, verse 21, he will make them one nation in the land, verse 22, one king shall be over them, and they'll never be divided again. And all their transgressions, idolatry, all of their sin will be removed by God himself, verse 23, for he will cleanse them. The word cleanse, it's a Hebrew word. It's used 35 times in the book of Leviticus for the ceremonial cleansing that was performed upon a person by the high priest so as to reinstate that Israelite back into fellowship with God. The use of the word here is speaking specifically of the cleansing blood of Jesus Christ, the great high priest, who will reinstate the children of Israel back into their fellowship and their service to God. When they as a nation are regenerated or born again, prior to entering the 1,000-year reign of Christ in his coming earthly kingdom, when, verse 24 says, David, my servant, shall be king over them, and they shall all have one shepherd. They shall also walk in my judgments and observe my statutes and do them. Then they shall dwell in the land that I have given to Jacob, my servant, where their fathers dwelt. And they shall dwell there, they, their children, their children's children forever. And my servant David shall be their prince forever. Now this gives us a really interesting perspective on how Israel will be governed during the 1,000-year reign of Christ. And we've gone over how the whole government, there's going to be an established government within that reigning time of Christ over the earth for 1,000 years. But here David is spoken of specifically, as having a personal position of ruling over the nation of Israel during that coming kingdom age, as it's called in the Old Testament. Now, some have interpreted this as speaking symbolically of Jesus Christ, of the line of David, when he sits on the earthly throne in that coming kingdom. It's very important to understand what this is saying. There's nothing in the language of the prophecies here in Ezekiel that force that interpretation. In fact, you'll notice David is referred to as both king, verse 24, and prince, son of a king, in verse 25, a dual title. Now, Jesus had asked the Pharisees at one point about the Messiah. He said, "Whose son is he?" Matthew 22, 42. And they answered, "The Messiah's son of David." He said, "Well, how then does David in the spirit call him Lord?" Jesus asked them rhetorically, quoting David from Psalm 110, where David wrote, "The Lord, Jehovah," or Yahweh, "said to my Lord Adonai, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool." It's a messianic psalm in which David portrays the Messiah as his Lord. Jesus said, if David calls him Lord, how is he his son? And no one was able to answer him a word, it says, nor did they dare question anymore. That was a pivotal question. Very important point, in other words. And they said, we can't answer that. The picture in prophetic scriptures like this is of a resurrected King David ruling over the regenerated, born-again nation of Israel during the coming kingdom age under the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ, making David both a king in the sense of having rule over this unified, regenerated nation of Israel throughout the 1,000 years, but also being in subjection to the ultimate ruler, the Messiah, King Jesus. If David calls him Lord, how is he his son? Jesus asks. Well, when Jesus came to this world the first time, he came as a descendant of King David. But when he comes again, he will come as King David's Lord and Savior, placing King David in subjection to him as a prince. Jesus will be ruling over multiple earthly entities. Israel is just one, and King David is going to have a place of rulership over them. Jesus is going to be ruling over his church. His church will be ruling and reigning with him. There will be other nations. We'll see as we get into the final chapters of this book, there'll be other nations that will enter into the kingdom age. All of this is going to be a lot of activity. Israel will be one entity there. They're going to enter in physical bodies, the remnant of Israel that is left on this earth after the tribulation period. They're going to enter in physical bodies, but they're all going to be born again. In fact, everyone who enters in will be born again. But as Paul says, everyone in Israel will get saved throughout the whole 1,000-year reign. But there will be Gentiles who will be born, who will reject the salvation during that time. The church will be glorified. Old Testament saints will be resurrected. The first resurrection, Revelation 20 says, will bring glorified Old Testament saints such as David. Also, it's going to be an incredible time. You don't want to miss it because it's going to be a fabulous time to be on this earth. And a lot different than the days we're living in today. But speaking of Israel, verse 26, moreover, he says, I will make a covenant of peace with them, and it shall be an everlasting covenant with them. So here, you know, just as Isaiah, Jeremiah, now Ezekiel all prophesy of what we know as the new covenant that our Lord Jesus Christ established while he was here on earth. He instituted it in what we call the Last Supper. This is the blood of the new covenant, and then he ratified it when he went to the cross, made all the spiritual principles and promises attached to the new covenant available for anyone who wants to come under the new covenant. And through Israel's receiving of Jesus as their Lord and Savior, becoming born again as a nation, there will be a fulfillment of everything that Israel's wilderness relationship with God represented. So he's speaking about at the end of verse 26. It says, I will establish them and multiply them. I will set my sanctuary in their midst forever. My tabernacle also shall be with them. Indeed, I will be their God, and they shall be my people. The nations, the Goyim again also, will know that I, the Lord, sanctify Israel when my sanctuary is in their midst forever. The book of Hebrews, chapter 8, says that the priesthood and all the different elements used for worship under the old covenant, even the tabernacle itself, it was all symbolic of a better covenant that was to come, the new covenant. A covenant that would make those who worship God able to come to him directly, always without any hindrance, as has taken place when Christ, our high priest, came with a greater, more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation, not with the blood of goats and calves, Hebrews 9:12 says, but with his own blood, he entered the most holy place, not the earthly holy of holies, but he entered heaven itself, it says, once for all, having obtained eternal redemption. So that if the blood of animals purified the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, how much more will his sacrifice cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? It's a rhetorical question. How much more, dude, if animals were able to take a person's sins, at least cover them, how much more shall the eternal sacrifice of Jesus Christ? I've been teaching the book of Hebrews every Tuesday in New Lisbon Correctional Center. Been teaching there for 13, 14 years. The group of men, 40 men, for them to hear promises like that. Dude, your conscience is clean if you are born again. The evil, vile things you've done has put you in a cage. Dude, they've been cleansed away. Your conscience is clear. To hear, might have a clear conscience. You tell inmates that, dude, they are set free. They are more free than a lot of people I know here on the outside of those walls. 2,500 years ago, the prophet Ezekiel prophesied of that eternal cleansing sacrifice of the Messiah that Israel will receive in that future day. And when they do, the nations, verse 28, will know that I, the Lord, sanctify Israel when my sanctuary is in their midst forevermore. Israel's unique position as God's chosen nation will be shown forth from their position of serving the King of all the earth during that 1,000-year reign of Christ. Under the leadership of a resurrected King David, we'll see that further on in chapters 40 through 48. But their preparation for the regeneration of them as a nation is going to come through this significant event known as this invasion. Gog and Magog. We'll break that down in chapter 38 next time. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for your incredible word, Lord. There's no other book like this, God. There's no other book in existence that it can give such accurate details of the events of this day. Lord, we're living in a world full of lies. The media lies, the government lies, the whole world, Lord, your book is true. And it's shown to be true over and over. God, thank you that we have an anchor for our souls. God, thank you that we have a compass by which to navigate this upside down world we're living in. We love you, Lord. I pray that this time of prayer, God, we as a church need to be interceding as never before. And I pray that our prayer time tonight, God, would be powerful. It would be effectual. It would avail much. God, we intercede for one another, for our nation, God, as we are called to do as the church. Hear our prayers tonight, God. We love you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
joy inside. So I start to see but I can't sing loud enough. I can't sing loud enough when I'm singing for you.
For it all, God, and thank you, Lord, that you receive us as we are, God, as sinful and broken, God, and thank you for how you make us clean, you make us new, Lord, and you already see us as redeemed, God, and I just praise you, Lord, for this night, Lord, bless this time as we pray, God, in your name I pray, amen.